Good morning, dear students. We are back with our video lessons in biology. In this video, we will be focusing on chapter 5 from your textbook, coordination, the linking system. So I hope you are all fit and fine, ready to listen to your class, isn't it? So, as soon as you have got up in the morning, you must have performed a lot of activities to get ready for your class. Like having your bath, getting ready, walking to the dining table to have your breakfast, a little bit of exercise maybe, and such things you would have done. And then you are now sitting at your place to listen to class. All these activities you are able to do perfectly well, right? So right from the beginning, from the time you get up from your bed till the time you sleep, you perform all your activities perfectly well without any problem. Fine. How could you do this? You did not lose your balance anywhere. You did not slip and fall down anywhere. And what you wanted to do, you did it perfectly well. Fine. All this involves three basic processes called movement, balance, and coordination. So all the activities that a human body performs involves movement, balance, and coordination. So you are able to move perfectly well from one place to another. You want to move only your hand to pick up something from the ground? Yes, you can do it. If you want to catch something that somebody throws from somewhere, you want to catch a ball your friend throws, you are able to bring your hands to position and you are able to catch the ball. So any movement that the body has to perform, like moving from one place to another place or just in one place and moving certain parts of your body, you are able to do it perfectly well. And then these movements have a certain balance. So after catching the ball that your friend throws, you can hold it in position. You are not falling down, your hands are not falling down, or your hands are not losing the position. So this involves balance. Even sitting straight, erect in your place, that also requires certain balance. Standing on both your feet also requires balance. So movement and balance involves the skeletal system and the muscular system. Skeletal system is the bony framework that the human body has, and muscles are helping the skeletal system in the movement by contractions and relaxations. So not just the skeletal muscles and skeletal system and the muscular system, all tissues, all organs and all the cells, they are having a balance. They are having some coordination. So there is coordination in all the organs and all the organ systems in our body. This is what we have to understand in this video. We will be learning how all the systems are able to function in coordination. Like for example, there is coordination between your eye and your brain and your body and the ear also. Like if you hear a horn when you are on the road and you hear somebody sounding the horn at your back, you catch the sound and your body moves to one side, giving way for the vehicle to pass by. So this type of coordination is there between all the cells, all the organs and organ system, even the sensory system also is having coordination. So to understand this coordination, first we will try to understand what is response to stimuli. What is stimulus? Change in the environment is called stimulus. And the response which comes out of the the change, because of the change, is called the response to stimulus. So stimulus is singular, stimuli is plural. Response to stimuli is the change in the body of the organism or the human being when there is any change in the environment. For example, it is hot and humid outside. So my body responds to the humidity by sweating. I start sweating once the climate has changed. Fine. A cat starts running because it has seen a mouse. Okay? So there is a change in the environment. It has seen the mouse and the cat is responding by running towards the mouse. So this is there in every organism, but specifically we will be learning in response to the human body. Fine. So coordination in the body involves integrating pathways, and this integrating pathways is possible because of the nervous system. Earlier, it was thought that only the brain is there performing all these functions. But a Greek physiologist called Galen, his work on the brain and the nervous system later led to various developments. And these developments now tell that there is a nervous system along with the functioning along with the brain. So this scientist Galen, he could discover this nervous system because one patient had come to him with a blow on his neck, and after the blow was there on his neck, he lost only the sensation in his hand, but he could move his hand perfectly well. So then it was then that Galen thought that there might be nerves for sensation and nerves for action. So apart from the brain, there is a nervous system and there are different types of nerves too. So before we go on to the different types of nerves, first we have to understand the nerve cell. The nerve cell is also called neuron. The neuron is the structural and functional unit of the nervous system.
Let us study about the nerve cell in detail. Our nervous system consists of 10 billion neurons which are communicating with each other. Each nerve cell has a cell body. The cell body, also called cyton, has a prominent nucleus. Inside the cell body, there are small granules called Nissl granules. The cell body has fine projections and one long projection. The small projections are called dendrites, and the long extension is called the axon. The axon is covered by a sheath called myelin sheath. Myelin sheath is made up of fatty substances and acts as insulating layer. Myelin sheath allows electrical impulses to be transmitted quickly and efficiently along the nerve cells. Now, there are some nerve cells which do not have myelin sheath. They are called unmyelinated nerve cells. Unmyelinated nerve fibers conduct impulses at lower speed. Myelinated nerve cells, they conduct impulse at a faster rate. The myelin sheath is made up of cells called Schwann cells. So this myelin sheath is not a continuous layer. It is interrupted at regular intervals. And those interruptions, the place where they are interrupted, it is called node of Ranvier. The cell body of the nerve cell, it lies in the brain or in the spinal cord or in a region called dorsal or ventral root ganglion. You can understand the dorsal or ventral root ganglion if you look at the horizontal section of the spinal cord. In this horizontal section of spinal cord, you can see the blue line representing the dorsal root ganglion and the red line representing the ventral root ganglion. There the cell body lies. The nerve cell is connected to each other. Cells are connected to each other through a region of contact, and that region of contact is called synapse. How is a synapse formed? Dendrites of one nerve cell connect to the axon of another nerve cell, and that point of contact is called a synapse. Synapse is the functional region of contact where information from one neuron is relayed to another neuron. These are actually minute gaps and they are not any direct cell-to-cell connection or protoplasmic connection. They are just gaps, but still information is passed by chemical signals, or information can be passed by electrical signals, or sometimes both chemical and electrical signals. Let us try to understand the reflex arc. A reflex action is an involuntary and instant movement in response to a stimulus. Most sensory neurons do not pass directly to the brain, but they synapse in the spinal cord. A reflex is made possible by a neural pathway called reflex arc. The reflex arc can act on an impulse before the impulse reaches the brain. So such a single pathway going up to the spinal cord from detectors and returning to effectors is called the reflex arc. If we accidentally touch a sharp surface with our feet, several such arcs will operate and they will cause the muscles of the leg to withdraw the feet immediately. We also have an interesting fact to note about the knee-jerk reflex. So, thigh muscles contracting involuntarily. You can make a person sit in a proper position so that the lower half of the legs are hanging freely, and you can strike the area just above the kneecap sharply while grasping the front part of the thigh with the other hand. You can observe that the thigh muscles are contracting and the thigh muscles will change their shape. Even though the person is fully conscious, the thigh muscles cannot be prevented from contracting. The thigh muscles are here acting involuntarily. This is called the knee-jerk reflex. This knee-jerk reflex led to understanding about a pathway, nerve pathway called the reflex arc. So from this we can understand that voluntary pathways take a longer traveling through the brain, but the involuntary actions are carried out in short intervals of time, and this short period is because of the presence of reflex arc. Let us understand the different types of nerves. First one is the afferent neuron. Afferent neuron is also called sensory neuron. Afferent nerves carry messages from nerve endings on the muscles of different sense organs to the central nervous system, which is the brain or spinal cord. These nerves are also called sensory nerves. Secondly, we have the efferent neurons. These efferent neurons carry messages from the central nervous system to parts that have to carry out the response. The part which has to carry out the response is the effector. They are the muscles. So, the efferent neurons are also called motor nerves or motor neurons. Thirdly, we also have the association nerves. The association nerves link together the afferent and the efferent nerves. So these are the three types of neurons present in our nervous system.